This is a talk on Rothman-Thompson syndrome, or RTS. This talk was given as part of the first Rothman-Thompson Syndrome Foundation Sharing and Caring Conference, which was held in 2012 in the state of Virginia. This talk is dedicated to Victoria Kimmel, who has inspired and touched each and every one of us in the RTS community. To give a little bit of historical background about RTS, it was first described in 1868 by Dr. August Rothman, who was a German ophthalmologist. He examined a little boy who had a very unique skin rash along with bilateral juvenile cataracts. Rothman traveled to the isolated area of the Bavarian Alps where the patient's family came from, and to his surprise he found at least one family with multiple affected children in each village. Even at that time, Dr. Rothman concluded that this was probably the result of some sort of inherited disease. Then separately in 1923, Dr. Sidney Thompson, who was a British dermatologist, described a similar rash in two sisters, but instead of the cataracts, he saw that they had skeletal or bone abnormalities. He coined the term poikiloderma congenitale to describe this condition. Then, in 1957, Dr. William Taylor, who was a dermatologist at the University of Michigan in the United States, proposed that the two disorders described by Rothman and Thompson were the same, and he proposed the eponym Rothman-Thompson syndrome, which is how we know the disorder today. The clinical features of Rothman-Thompson syndrome include a characteristic skin rash, as described by Rothman and Thompson, which is called poikiloderma, and I'll show a few pictures of that in a moment. In addition, patients can have many other clinical features, including symmetrical small stature, sparse or even absent scalp hair, eyebrows, and or eyelashes, hyperkeratosis or thickening, especially of the soles and palms of the hands and feet, skeletal or bone abnormalities, including radial ray defects, dental and nail abnormalities, nonspecific gastrointestinal disturbance, usually in childhood, as well as the juvenile cataracts described by Rothman. Importantly, these patients have an increased risk of developing skin cancer, typically squamous or basal cell carcinomas, as well as bone cancer or osteosarcoma. These are some pictures of the characteristic skin rash of RTS. The rash typically starts in infancy as acute erythema on the cheeks. It then tends to spread to affect the extensor surfaces on the arms and the legs, and it can either spare or affect the buttocks. The rash gradually evolves into a chronic pattern of poikiloderma, which consists of lacy hyper and hypopigmentation, punctate atrophy, and telangiectasias. This rash persists for life. These are some more pictures illustrating the rash. As you can see, it typically affects the cheeks on these two children. The baby on the right, as you can see, has no eyebrows or eyelashes. This shows the rash as it affects the extremities on the arms. It typically spares the trunk, abdomen, and back. These are more pictures of the rash on the legs. Patients can also have radial ray defects, which are abnormalities of the radius bone in the arm. And this is manifested as either absent or malformed thumbs. And on the picture on the left, you can see this was actually an index finger that was pollicized into a thumb. These are more pictures of the radial ray defects manifested as rudimentary or malformed thumbs. These are typically just removed since they are non-functional. Patients can also have abnormal nails, either thin, fragile, or malformed. We began our studies of Rothman-Thompson syndrome in 1999 when we examined an 11-year-old boy who was newly diagnosed with osteosarcoma or bone cancer at Texas Children's Hospital in Houston, Texas. He also carried a diagnosis of RTS since infancy. Interestingly, his sister had also been diagnosed with RTS and she had died of metastatic osteosarcoma. So the question in our minds was, is there any link between these two very rare diseases? At the time, the literature consisted mainly of isolated case reports. There were approximately 200 case reports in the English language literature, and approximately 10 of those described osteosarcoma. In order to better understand the clinical features of RTS and to understand the exact prevalence of the various findings, we conducted a study of 41 subjects with RTS in order to better define the clinical features. What we found was that all patients, or 100%, had some aspect of the characteristic skin rash. The other features, such as small stature and bone abnormalities and sparse hair, eyebrows, or eyelashes, were pretty consistent with what was described in the literature. What was different was that we found that only about 6% had the cataracts described by Rothman, whereas in the literature, it was found in 50%. Importantly, we also found that 32% of patients had a diagnosis of osteosarcoma, suggesting that osteosarcoma and RTS are truly linked. Based on our clinical findings, we propose diagnostic criteria for RTS. Definite RTS would be diagnosed in the case of the characteristic rash that I described earlier that starts with the acute phase and then evolves into the chronic phase of poikiloderma. Probable RTS would be diagnosed in the case of an atypical rash, so either it did not start in infancy or didn't spread in the pattern as described, but in addition, the patient would need to have two additional features listed here. These are our current demographics of RTS subjects enrolled in our Baylor College of Medicine RTS study. In total, we have 115 subjects with RTS. All races and multiple nationalities are represented. In addition to the RTS subjects themselves, we also enroll parents who are obligate heterozygotes, as well as full siblings and other relatives. In addition to obtaining clinical information, we also obtain biologic samples from RTS patients as well as family members. We attempt to collect a blood sample from which we can extract DNA and establish immortalized lymphoblastoid cell lines. We also try to obtain a skin punch biopsy to establish primary fibroblasts and cultures. These samples are very important for doing research studies in the laboratory on RTS. We have established a clinical tracking database, and we obtain information on a yearly basis from patients and families. This will allow us to describe the natural history of RTS and to understand the full clinical manifestations in RTS patients as well as their family members. When we started our research, the cause of RTS was unknown. It was known to be an inherited disorder and transmitted in an autosomal recessive pattern. Finally, in 1999, a gene for RTS was discovered. The gene was described first by Kitao et al. In Japan, and the gene's name is RETQL4. It was found to be mutated in 3 out of the 7 RTS cases that they studied. What is the RETQL4 gene? This gene is located on chromosome 8. It belongs to a family of related genes called the RETQ genes. This family encodes proteins that are felt to be important in maintaining the stability of our genomes, that is, the genetic material or DNA. The RETQ genes are evolutionarily conserved among all species. In humans, there are 5 RETQ genes. RETQL2, 3, and 4 are associated with human disorders. They are Werner syndrome, Bloom syndrome, and Rothman-Thompson syndrome, respectively. Thus far, there have been no human disorders associated with the RETQL1 and RETQL5 genes. This is just a diagram showing the different RETQ proteins that are evolutionarily conserved, from E. coli, which is bacteria, to Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which are yeast, all the way up to Homo sapiens or humans. As you can see, for the humans, there are the 5 RETQ helicases that I described earlier. These helicases are defined by a conserved region, which is boxed and are shown in green. This is just a diagram to depict some of the functions that have been described for RETQL4. It plays a role primarily in DNA replication, base excision repair, which is a form of DNA repair, as well as repair of double-strand breaks. As I mentioned earlier, there are 3 human diseases associated with the RETQ genes: Bloom syndrome, Werner syndrome, and Rothman-Thompson syndrome. All 3 syndromes share similar features of growth insufficiency, some features of premature aging, and skin findings. Importantly, they all have a risk for cancer predisposition. However, the types of cancer differ between the different diseases. Bloom syndrome patients tend to have cancer seen in the general population, including leukemia, lymphoma, epithelial cancers, as well as solid tumors. Werner syndrome patients, who are sort of premature aging syndrome patients, have a more restricted cancer pattern, including soft tissue sarcomas, skin cancer, primarily melanomas, as well as thyroid cancer. These patients can also develop osteosarcoma. Rothman-Thompson syndrome is uniquely and highly predisposed to osteosarcoma, as well as non-melanoma skin cancers, including squamous and basal cell carcinoma. In terms of RETQL4 mutations in RTS patients, they are found in 2/3 of subjects with RTS. We call these patients type 2 RTS, and they are at increased risk of developing osteosarcoma and of having bone abnormalities. RETQL4 mutations are not found in the other 1/3 of subjects with a clinical diagnosis of RTS, and we call these patients type 1 RTS. Their disease is likely due to other genes which have not currently been identified. So as I mentioned, multiple genes may be responsible for causing one disease. So that would be, for example, type 2 and type 1 RTS. However, the opposite is also true in that one gene can cause multiple syndromes. So now we know that RETQL4 not only causes Rothman-Thompson syndrome, but is also responsible for 2 other syndromes, Rapodillino and Ballard-Giroud syndrome. Rapodillino syndrome was first described in Finland, and it consists of the following features, many of which overlap with patients with RTS. These include radial aplasia, absent patella or high arch palate, diarrhea or dislocated joints, little size or limb malformations, long nose, and normal intelligence. Importantly, these patients do not have the classic poikiloderma seen in RTS. Rhabdolina was first described in 1989. It's a Finnish disease heritage. It was first described in the Finnish population. It is also autosomal recessive in inheritance, and there's a lot of clinical overlap with RTS. They do not have poikiloderma, and in the original paper by Sitonen et al., they were described as not having a significant cancer risk. Sitonen et al. Later followed up on their original cohort of Finnish patients, and what they found was that 6 out of 15, or 40%, with RET-Q04 mutations eventually developed cancer. 27% of these cancers were lymphomas, and 13% were osteosarcomas. Thus, rhabdolina is also a cancer predisposition syndrome. Ballard-Gerald syndrome was first described in 1950 by Dr. Friedrich Baller and then by Dr. Gerald in 1959. Similar to RTS, the eponym was coined by Dr. Michael Cohen separately in 1975. Ballard-Gerald syndrome is also autosomal recessive in inheritance, and there have been approximately 24 cases reported in the literature so far. The major clinical findings of Ballard-Gerald syndrome are craniosynostosis, and this is when the normal sutures of the skull prematurely fuse, as well as the radial aplasia and hypoplasia and poikiloderma, although this is not seen in all patients. Ballard-Gerald syndrome patients can also have many other manifestations as shown below. Mutations in the RET-Q04 gene were first described in two Ballard-Gerald syndrome patients from two families in 2006. There has been one case of cancer described in Ballard-Gerald syndrome in a 7-year-old girl who had the poikiloderma and hyperkeratosis. She was tested for RET-Q04 mutations and was found to have them, and she developed a lymphoma at age 2.5 years. Currently, we think of these diseases as the RET-Q04 spectrum of diseases, and as you can see in this diagram, there are a lot of overlapping features, while there are some features that are more specific for the particular individual diseases. Importantly, all of these patients have features of skeletal dysplasias or bone problems. Clinical testing for mutations in the RET-Q04 gene is now available through the Baylor Medical Genetics Laboratories, as well as through several other laboratories throughout the world. Now I'm going to focus a little bit more on the bone diseases found in Rothman-Thompson syndrome. Bone abnormalities in Rothman-Thompson syndrome were first described by Dr. Thompson in one of his patients, and this is an excerpt from his original article. There are very definite bony deformities. The metacarpals and phalanges of both hallucines are completely absent, whilst both ulnae and radii are rudimentary, the latter particularly so. What he's talking about here are the radial ray defects and absent thumbs seen in RTS. The bone findings in RTS include, as mentioned previously, radial ray defects and missing thumbs, abnormally shaped bones, fused bones, frontal bossing, saddle nose, and bone cancer or osteosarcoma. In terms of osteosarcoma, we found that 30% of our initial clinical cohort had this type of bone tumor. 2/3 of our RTS patients had mutations in the RET-Q04 gene. So the question that we had was, does the presence of mutations in RET-Q04 correlate with the development of osteosarcoma? And is there any way to predict who will develop osteosarcoma? So in order to answer this question, we sequenced the DNA of 33 individuals with RTS to look for mutations in their RET-Q04 genes. 11 of those individuals have been diagnosed with osteosarcoma. This is just a picture showing the gene structure of RET-Q04. The boxes denote the exons or the coding regions of the gene, while the interspersed lines denote introns or non-coding regions of the gene. In summary, we identified 19 different mutations in RET-Q04 among this cohort of patients. 23 out of 33, or 2/3, of those with RTS had at least one mutation, while 10 subjects, or 1/3, had no mutations. In order to quantify whether or not the presence of mutations correlated with the risk of osteosarcoma, we conducted Kaplan-Meier analyses. This is just the graph showing the Kaplan-Meier survival curve. And what you see is that there are two groups of patients. The one on the top are those without mutations in RET-Q04, and the group on the bottom are the patients with RET-Q04 mutations. On the y-axis is the percent not diagnosed with osteosarcoma over time on the x-axis. And what you see is patients without mutations do not develop osteosarcoma. They remain osteosarcoma-free over time, where the patients with mutations, very few of those remained osteosarcoma-free over time. This suggests that indeed there's a connection between having RET-Q04 mutations and developing osteosarcoma. This is just another way to look at the data. And what you see is that there are patients with osteosarcoma or without, and patients with or without RET-Q04 mutations. All the patients with osteosarcoma, 17, had RET-Q04 mutations, where none of the patients without mutations developed osteosarcoma. Again, suggesting that having RET-Q04 mutations highly predisposes to developing osteosarcoma. Based on the clinical molecular spectra of RTS, we propose that there are two types of RTS. Type 1, which are the patients with classic poikiloderma but without mutations in RECQL4. These patients probably have a less risk of cancer, and these are the original Rothman phenotype with the bilateral juvenile cataracts. Type 2 RTS patients are those who, again, have the classic features with poikiloderma, but they have mutations in RECQL4 and are at increased risk for developing osteosarcoma and bone abnormalities. The type 1 patients suggest genetic heterogeneity, that is, that there are other genes that cause the clinical disease RTS, and the type 2 patients give us further impetus to study the RECQL4 pathways in the pathogenesis of osteosarcoma. So one of the questions that comes up not infrequently from clinicians taking care of patients with osteosarcoma is, if there's a patient with RTS who develops osteosarcoma, can they be treated the same as osteosarcoma patients without RTS? Will these patients have more toxicities from chemotherapy, and are their clinical outcomes the same? So just a little background on sporadic osteosarcoma, that is, osteosarcoma occurring in the general population. Osteosarcoma is the most common malignant bone tumor in children and adolescents. Patients typically present with pain in the affected bone with no systemic symptoms, so they don't usually have fever, weight loss, or anorexia. The peak age is during the teenage years. This shows the distribution of osteosarcoma in children. It most commonly occurs around the knee, so typically in the distal femur, which is the bone in the upper leg, or the proximal tibia, which is the bone in the lower leg. It can also occur in the proximal humerus or the upper arm bone. Axial lesions, for example, in the pelvis or the spine, are less common. Osteosarcoma can either be localized, that is, only occur in the bone that it starts, or it can also be metastatic, which means that it has spread to other parts of the body, most typically the lungs and other bones. About 25% of patients present with metastatic disease. In terms of the histologic subtypes of osteosarcoma, the most common histologic type is conventional osteosarcoma, and this consists of osteoblastic, chondroblastic, and fibroblastic forms. The sine qua non of osteosarcoma is the production of osteoid or new bone formation. Patients with osteosarcoma can be graded histologically based on their tumor response to chemotherapy. Patients with grade 3 or 4 tumors, which show less than 10% viable tumor or complete necrosis of the tumor, are considered good responders, whereas the grade 1 and 2 patients, that is, less than 90% tumor necrosis or minimal response, are considered poor responders. Typically, about 45% will be good responders. In terms of outcomes with osteosarcoma, about 65% of patients with localized or non-metastatic disease are cured, whereas less than 20% of patients with metastatic or recurrent disease are cured. Importantly, there have been no significant improvements in the cure rates for either group in the past 30 years. Thus, research into molecular bases and the pathways responsible for osteosarcoma are very important. So in order to better understand osteosarcoma and RTS, we looked at those features that I mentioned earlier, including the age at diagnosis, the location, histologic subtype, tumor response to chemotherapy, toxicities to chemotherapy, and the overall patient outcomes. We identified 12 subjects with RTS, age range 4 to 20 years, who had been diagnosed with osteosarcoma. The median age at diagnosis was 10 years old, which is younger than in the general population. All subjects received chemotherapy and surgery. These are some of our results. First of all, the location of osteosarcoma is similar to the general population, that is, in the distal long bones, typically around the knee. The histologic subtypes also were very similar to the general population. 75% were of the conventional subtype. In terms of histologic or tumor response, this again was very similar to the general population, with about 45% having a good response. For overall patient outcomes, 9 patients are alive and disease-free, which is again similar to the general population of about 65% survival for localized disease. In terms of toxicities to chemotherapy, 5 subjects had toxicities without any modifications in their chemotherapy dosing. 4 had toxicities to doxorubicin, which is one of the chemotherapy agents used to treat osteosarcoma, and they required modifications, but the maximum modification was 25%. 2 subjects were actually started at lower doses of chemotherapy up front. And for 2 subjects, we did not have treatment data. So in conclusion, osteosarcoma in RTS patients occurs at a younger age compared to the general population. The locations and histologic subtypes of osteosarcoma in RTS patients do not differ greatly from that in the general population. Some patients with RTS and osteosarcoma had enhanced sensitivity to doxorubicin, usually in the form of severe mucositis or mouth lesions, while others tolerated it well. Thus, there is no way to predict a priori who will have more sensitivity to chemotherapy. Our recommendations are to counsel RTS patients with RECQL4 mutations for the awareness of osteosarcoma risk, obtain baseline skeletal surveys to define the underlying bone abnormalities. Thus, if a patient has a complaint such as bone pain, they can obtain a follow-up x-ray to see if this is a new lesion that needs to be biopsied. Treat osteosarcoma with standard chemotherapy with no upfront reductions. Modify chemotherapy only as dictated by the clinical course of the individual patient. So in terms of the skeletal findings in RTS, we know that patients can have radial ray defects because these are things that we can see on physical exam. But we also wondered whether or not they had other bone abnormalities that were not visible by physical exam. So in order to answer this question, we conducted a study of 28 patients with RTS, and they all had skeletal surveys to examine their bones. And what we found was that 75% had major skeletal abnormalities that could be seen by x-ray. The most common findings are listed here, and I will go through these in the subsequent slides. So this is an x-ray where the bones appear white and the other tissues appear darker. And this is an example of brachymesophalange that was seen in 64% of RTS patients. And what this means is that the middle bone of the fingers is shorter than it should be. And typically this occurred in the index finger and the fifth fingers together. Here you can see the brachymesophalange with associated clinodactyly, which is just the curving of the fingers. This is a picture of thumb hypoplasia, which was seen in 43% of patients, as well as thumb aplasia, or complete absence of the thumb, which was seen in 43% of patients. In addition, we found that several patients had synostoses or fusion of bones, and this is an example of radio-ulnar synostosis, where the radius bone and the ulna bone in the forearm are fused, as shown here. A picture of a normal elbow is shown on the right side. This is another example of radio-ulnar synostosis seen in a different patient. And this is a picture showing radio-humeral synostosis, so fusion of the humerus or upper arm bone to the lower bone of the arm, shown here. In addition, patients were found to have metaphyseal trabecular defects, and the metaphysis is the area of the bone near the ends of the bone or the growth plates. And these defects consisted of these lines, either horizontal or vertical lines seen here. And this was found in 64% of patients. These are more examples of the metaphyseal trabecular defects, also shown here. Osteopenia, or quote, thinning of the bones, was seen in 25% of patients. Here you can see an x-ray on the right side of normal bone mineral density, so there's more white in the bone, whereas on the left side, this is an x-ray of osteopenia where the bones appear less dense. In order to determine whether or not the presence of reticulophore mutations correlated with having these skeletal problems, we performed genotype-phenotype analysis, and again we showed that the presence of reticulophore mutations was statistically correlated with the presence of any skeletal defects. Thus, reticulophore mutations are associated with bone abnormalities. In terms of osteoporosis, among the skeletal defects seen on x-rays of RTS patients, we found osteopenia in 25%. Osteopenia is considered a precursor to osteoporosis, and some of the patients had reported histories of frequent fractures as young children. Some of them had also been placed on medications to treat osteoporosis. So the question we had was, what is the basis for the low bone mass phenotype seen on x-rays, and does this really represent osteoporosis that is seen in the general elderly population? And can it be treated with the same drugs? So in order to answer this question, we are currently conducting a study at Baylor College of Medicine, which consists of two parts. One is a clinical study of RTS patients, and in this study, we're going to perform DEXA scanning, which is the accurate way to determine whether or not there's osteoporosis. We will also conduct laboratory tests, which are bone and urine tests, to look at markers of bone turnover to get a sense of whether or not these patients have increased bone turnover leading to osteoporosis. And we'll also conduct IV calcium labeling studies, which also gives an idea of bone turnover in these patients. The second part of our research is conducted in the laboratory, and in order to do this, we're going to generate mouse models of RTS, which will allow us to perform detailed studies of the bone defects in reticulophore deficient mice. This will give us a good idea about the cellular basis of the bone defects seen in RTS patients. So in summary, Rothman-Thompson syndrome is a heterogeneous disorder with a distinct and high risk for osteosarcoma. Bone abnormalities in osteosarcoma are seen in type 2 RTS and are associated with reticulophore mutations. The gene or genes for type 1 RTS are still unknown. Reticulophore is also mutated in Rapodillino and Ballard-Giroult syndromes. The reticulophore gene plays an important role in skeletal development and other bone diseases, such as osteoporosis. The combined study of human patients and mouse models will provide us clues about reticular force's specific function in the skeletal system. Exploring the RET-Q helicase pathways will teach us about the pathogenesis of osteosarcoma and may provide opportunities for novel therapies for this type of cancer. And finally, rare diseases can teach us a lot more about common diseases. This is just a picture of some of our patients who participated in our Baylor College of Medicine study on RTS. Thank you for your attention, and I hope you've learned something from this presentation about Roffman-Thompson syndrome. To go to the Foundation website, please go to www.rtsplace.org.